Good morning, good afternoon, or good night, depending where you are right now. We hope that all of you and your families are doing quite well in these days. My name is Esteban Silva Villa, assistant professor at the University of Antioquia in Colombia, and it's a great pleasure to be part of the organization of this astronomy twinning program between the Leiden Observatory and the University of Antioquia AstroTwin Colo. This year, we have the honor to host 5 young researchers from different institutions around the globe who will be teaching about astrochemistry and X-ray. This 2021 school will be fully online. However, some of our students here at the university will be in person at the university, by the way. Having an online school in astronomy has its own challenges, so please stay with us. We will try to provide all possible assistance for the teachers and for the participants. To attend the classes, you must be online using the YouTube channel of the undergraduate program of astronomy, which is in the poster and the website of our school. On behalf of the Leiden Observatory and the University of Antioquia, and on behalf of all of the organizing team, welcome to this year's school. Today, we will start the school with Dr. Edgar Mendoza. Dr. Edgar Mendoza started his career at the Universidad Industrial de Santander in 2009. He obtained his degree at the University Federal de Rio de Janeiro in 2014. He made his thesis on the areas of astrochemistry and molecular astrophysics, developing his work in collaboration with the Institute de Paleontology Astrophysique de Grenoble. Today, his research is focused on the psychochemist properties of protostellar ambients, aiming to understand the chemical evolution and physics of protoplanetary disk systems. Edgar uses radio astronomy, psychochemist of interstellar medium, and molecular and atomic spectroscopy. He's also interested in discussing about the origin of life in the cosmic context. Edgar, welcome to our school.
Thank you, Esteban. Thank you to all of you for the invitation. I'm very happy to be here and to speak a little about astrochemistry. It is a honor to share this material with all of you. And many, many thanks for the invitation. I'm really happy for that.
Thank you. Thank you for accepting the invitation. And the pleasure is our pleasure to have you here teaching us about astrochemistry, which is a subject that is not so common to hear in astronomy.
Yes, I hear about, but this is something new, the chemistry of the interstellar medium, detection of molecules, and all this is new in terms of new observations in radioastronomical wavelengths, let's say. And so I prepare a material to speak about detection of molecules in radio wavelengths and combining a little bit of general concepts about astrochemistry, and I hope that you will like this.
I will enjoy it a lot, and I'm sure that everybody will be enjoying as well as me, because this is, as you said, this is a new subject, and as I said, it's not very common to hear about this. So I will be here helping you. I am part of the organizing committee, but I'm also a student here, so I will learn a lot.
I hope so. Okay. And sorry for my English, because it's not my mother tongue, and it is not easy to do this in this way. But
no, it's perfectly understandable. No worries.
Be patient.
Okay, I will just put your screen. So now we are seeing your screen, Edgar. You're seeing your screen. I will be here with you all the time, and thank you very much for the invitation. The place is yours.
Okay. Thank you, Esteban, again, and thanks to all of you, organizers, for this invitation, for this space to speak about astrochemistry and X-rays, and it is a honor to be here sharing this space with other colleagues, as you said, Esteban. And on this occasion, I will speak, the title of the presentation is Chemistry of the Interstellar Medium, a observation of molecules at submillimeter wavelengths. And as Esteban said, my name is Edgar Mendoza, and this is in the framework of the 9th astronomy training program between the University of Antioquia and the Leiden Observatory. So Let me check here. Yes, you are watching the outline. Okay. So more or less for this first lecture, I organize the presentation in four sections, more or less. First of all, I would like to speak about some generalities on astrochemistry. Then I will move to speak about observing molecules in submillimeter wavelengths specifically. In spite of that, I will combine some concepts of infrared techniques of detection of molecules in terms of excitations and vibrations of molecules in the interstellar medium. And then I will move to the methods and the tools that are common to reduce data, to analyze data, to identify molecules, to estimate the physical conditions, and so on. And finally, I try to put together a material about implications and some challenges in astrochemistry in general, more or less taking into account our work in our group, and to speak about perspective, about which are the challenges in astrochemistry that we are facing at this moment in terms of observations, calculations, and experiments, and all this in the framework of the cures, because the next lectures will be very, very interesting, I think, because it will be about experiments and theoretical astrochemistry. So let's start. I put here this picture. I took that from the ESO webpage, which is, I like this picture because combines the desert, the telescope, ice, and a living organism looking for water, maybe. So, yeah, about generalities, let me share here, it's okay. So what is astrochemistry, or sometimes as it is known, like molecular astrophysics? So the essential subject matter of astrochemistry is the study of the formation, destruction, and excitation of chemical species, molecules, radicals, molecular ions in astronomical environments, and how this influences the structure, dynamics, and evolution of astronomical objects in galaxies, not only in the Milky Way, but in nearby galaxies too. So this is more or less the goal and the research field of astrochemistry. So it combines observations, astronomical observations at different wavelengths, mainly at submillimeter wavelengths due to the physical conditions of the interstellar medium, but it is possible to detect molecules, big molecules, at the infrared, and invisible, it is a different story. It is more related to electronic transitions and atoms and so on. So I put here in cyan color this part of observation because this is mainly the research field that I work at this moment. But it is quite important experimental work in astrochemistry because we need to study spectroscopy, the transitions, frequencies, and all this. And also we need to know which are the formation and destruction routes of molecules in a tentative to simulate interstellar conditions at very low temperatures and low pressures, low densities. And models are quite important because we need to with limitations in experiments or in observations, we need to simulate time scales in astronomy, which is of the order of millions of years, quantum calculations, and all these to explain why we observe molecules in interstellar mediums, besides molecular hydrogen, for instance. There are complex molecules So it is quite important to understand how these molecules are formed and how they evolve during the evolution, how they are formed, destroyed, and the abundances, and how the protostellar objects evolve in general. And the composition, it is important to know the composition of protostellar objects. I put here an image of a protoplanetary disk. And then, as we are right now in our solar system, a clean system with planets, moons, and comets, and with a particular chemical composition. So this is more or less the goal of astrochemistry. And revising discoveries, one of the first detections in terms of molecules and species like radicals, or we have the first evidence of CH in more or less in the 1937. And then recent detections like benzonitril, an aromatic molecule with a CN group, which was observed, published in 2018, and recently the molecule CH2CCCN, which is similar with a different molecule that we are working right now, but in other sources. So at the core of all this, we have that spectroscopy and quantum mechanics are very important to understand and to develop astrochemistry. So because all that we are observing are spectral lines, rotational lines, vibrational lines. So it is very important how molecules experiment rotations and vibrations, how they are excited, how can we detect of this emission coming from interstellar clouds. So spectroscopy and quantum mechanics are very important for the construction of astrochemistry in general. Molecular spectra are very complex because molecules can experiment different rotational and vibrational states. So it is very important to understand how the interstellar medium contributes with all these different excitation processes in molecules and in chemical species in general. So in retrospective, I put here an image combining three moments in history, let's say, the Newton's work about the light and dispersion of light. Then we have the spectroscope with all the contributions from Bunsen and Kirchhoff and modern observatories, like this picture coming from the Herschel. So as observed, as we observe some molecules at these wavelengths, I put this image, this spectra that I will speak again in the next slides, in the third part of the presentation. But more or less, this is a collection of multiple spectra collected during the last 5 years, more or less, using the Atacama Pathfinder experiment in Chile, close to the ALMA interferometer. So this is more or less the observations that we have. A lot of spectral lines which correspond with known molecules, maybe like CO, a very abundant one, isotopologous from CO with 13 carbon, 17 oxygen, 18 oxygen. Then we have CS, HCN. But if you go to the spectral noise, let's say, you can see a lot of lines which correspond to different type of molecules. You have complex organic molecules, you have small organic molecules. So our work basically is try to identify these spectral lines and to estimate the physical conditions of the environment, let's say temperatures, densities, and so on, in order to understand the physical conditions of these regions and how these molecules can be produced and survive in these environments. So this is about astrochemistry. So let's say about the interstellar medium, and this is about the material between the stars. Because it seems that between the stars, there is a kind of empty, opaque void, but it is not. It is full of a thin gas and dust, and this material is the raw material to form stars and, for instance, planetary systems with the evolution of these objects. So it is important to characterize what is the material present between the stars, right? So as it is not visible, let's say, but if you look with an infrared of 2 millimeter wavelength, it is possible to understand what is the chemical composition of this and the physical conditions of this region. So more or less all related to astrochemistry is associated with what is the material between the stars, which is fundamentally gas and dust. Okay, so this is a classical image, the Barna 68 dark globules, which were studied by the American astronomer the past century. So this is in comparison with this classical image, this is a more or less a new one, taking into account the Gaia's view of the Barna 68 dark cloud. So you can see this image, which is a composition of the density of the stars. And so we have in the middle of this a black region, which is more or less a very dense and cold environment between all this density of stars. So it is quite important to understand and to pay attention on this interstellar medium, the material between the stars. So if we check at different wavelengths, the composition or what is the morphology of this region or what is that in this dark cloud, B68, we can see, for instance, how that region looks at different wavelengths, infrared, basically. So we can see that in different wavelengths, we can observe what is the morphology of the region and how it looks like, right, at different wavelengths. So, yes. So more or less, this is the general concept of the interstellar medium, the material present between the stars, which is gas and dust at different temperatures, let's say. So the interstellar medium has different phases and components. You need to consider the stars close to this interstellar medium, because the radiation coming from the stars can excite molecules, can produce hotter regions in comparison with other ones. So in that sense, the interstellar medium has different phases and components. And here, this is a classical or a very well-known region, which is the Horsehead, as observed at different wavelengths, right, from visible to submillimeter wavelengths, like this one at the right. So at different wavelengths, we realize different phenomena, different processes of excitation, different physical conditions. And all this is very important to understand the entire evolution of the interstellar medium. So in terms of, let's say, temperatures, number densities, there is a classification of the phases and the components of the interstellar medium. With respect to, for instance, the gas components, we have neutral atomic material, molecules, and ionizing and coronal gas in the case of the regions closer to the stars, for instance. But at very distant regions, we have low temperatures, so molecules can survive in these environments, very, very cold, at very, very cold temperatures. For instance, lower than 50 Kelvin, let's say. So this is the classification of the different regions of the interstellar medium, coronal gas, H2 regions or ionized regions, intercloud gas, diffuse clouds, and molecular clouds. I put here in this cyan color because more or less these are those are the regions that we are studying at this moment, diffuse clouds and molecular clouds. We have very low temperatures in these regions, between more or less 10 Kelvin and 100 Kelvin. And the density is very low in comparison with terrestrial densities, for instance. And more or less, this is the classification of the regions of the terrestrial medium. And we have here, for instance, cold molecular clouds. They are very interesting because the molecules are formed in core regions on the surface of grains, and then by thermal shocks or radiation, they can be ejected to the gas phase through different processes. But in general, complex molecules are formed in the solid phase, and then they go to the gaseous phase of the interstellar medium. So our focus at this moment is how complex molecules can be formed in these cold environments. So solid state astrochemistry is quite important. And I use one of the subtitles that I like from a paper, a revision paper, in Thus We Trust, because the molecules are forming there in the surface of grains. For instance, this is a spectra, the infrared space observatory between more or less 2 and 200 microns. And we have all these signatures containing silicates, molecules in ices. We have formic acid, water, methane, CO2, and water. So this is a little similar with the case of comets, but in this case we have very, very small particles. But this is a spectra of in the solid state coming from infrared observations. But at infrared observation, we also have processes of emission, fundamentally coming from dust, silicates, amorphous carbon, and so on. But it is quite difficult to identify the spectral lines at this infrared wavelength, because molecules used to be large, like hydrocarbons problematic, and it is very, very difficult to identify which molecule correspond to this spectral emission. Okay, so as I told to you, gas and dust are key materials in the interstellar medium, so it is important to understand their composition, their temperatures, densities, and so on. In the case of the Milky Way, I put this here image, the Milky Way Untangled, which summarizes a map of the gas, dust, and charged particles in the galaxy, in our galaxy. But we need to put attention in particular in these two images, which correspond to the gas and the dust, the distribution of them in our galaxy. So this is a comparison between all the gas present in the Milky Way and the dust. So this material is quite important because for instance, molecular hydrogen is the most abundant molecule in the universe. But if you want to study how methanol or how formamide or how some organic molecules are formed in our galaxy, we need to understand this interaction between chemical processes in the gas and in the solid phase of the interstellar medium. So, okay, so if we want to talk about molecules and chemical species, molecular ions, we need to think about chemical elements, which are the building blocks of the molecules. So, as you know, probably all these elements are formed through nucleosynthesis in the core of the stars. So we have hydrogen, helium, carbon, oxygen, and this is the very well known image about the abundance of the elements of the cosmic abundance of the elements in the solar system. We have this kind of zigzag, which is related to nuclear properties of the atoms. So more or less all the chemistry that we are talking about is about the chemistry of carbon, or as chemists know, the organic chemistry. But nitrogen, oxygen, and hydrogen, and even, for instance, sulfur, silicon, they are very quite important elements in all this history about the formation of molecules in the interstellar medium. So more or less the raw materials of the molecules that we are paying attention at these wavelengths, all the elements, the key elements are present here, right? So the elements are the raw materials, and then the big question is how molecules are formed in the interstellar medium. How you start from hydrogen to a molecule like benzonitril, for instance, how that happens in the interstellar medium. That is the key question here. So there is this new concept, let's say the molecular universe, because at some millimeter wavelengths, today we know that there are a molecular universe, literally speaking, a lot of molecules present in different astronomical sources. In some sources, you can find a lot of nitrogen-bearing molecules, in other oxygen-bearing molecules. Why this happened? Why our solar system is so interesting? Why our planet has this composition in comparison, for instance, with the moon? Quite different. So it is very interesting to understand how is the chemical evolution of protostellar objects, for instance, right? So there are various routes of formations of molecules. Sometimes you can start from small molecules like COH2 ammonia, and then you can explain how these molecules form bigger molecules. But in other cases, it is possible to have big molecules like polyaromatic hydrocarbons, and then can produce smaller molecules by fragmentation or dissociation or ionization processes that destroy molecules, producing fragments. So there are bottom-up and top-down routes to explain abundances of interstellar molecules. In the next lectures, they will be interesting presentation about the experimental processes that my colleague will present the next day. So stay tuned. About molecular hydrogen, I took this molecule as an example because it's the most abundant one, molecular hydrogen, H2. Just two atoms of hydrogen to form H2, the most abundant molecule in the universe. So the big problem of that is that it is not possible to explain the abundance of hydrogen molecule via gas mechanisms. So it was necessary to include a third component, which is a grain. So two atoms of hydrogen can be stick to the surface of a grain, and then these atoms can migrate and form molecular hydrogen and then go to the gaseous phase again. So this is a paradigmatic example, like see the formation of molecular hydrogen in the interstellar medium, because many calculations and modelizations cannot explain the abundance of this molecule just using the gaseous phase. So it is necessary to include a surface. So, and this is the case for various molecules that we observe. It is necessary to include catalytic processes. And this is an image, for instance, of a grain, interstellar grain. Then we have hydrogen atoms being sticked in the surface. They can migrate, they can react under the stimulus of energy, of course, and then they can go to the gaseous phase again. And this is a very complex cycle between formation and destruction processes in the interstellar media. So there are a lot of studies trying to in order to understand how this happens at these temperatures and in these very weird conditions, which are the condition of the interstellar media in comparison with ours here in the planet. So it is important to take into account catalysis, things like adsorption, which is the attachment of molecules to a given surface. Then we have different kind of processes like chemisorption, physisorption, and desorption, which is the reverse of the adsorption. So this is very key to understand the chemistry of the interstellar medium. And surface migration, which is related to how atoms can migrate in a surface to react and produce stuff. Okay, so I found an interesting image from a book that I have, Physical Chemistry, a classic maybe in undergrad. When I was a student at the university. So this is an image about how a reaction looks on a surface. This is A, where this is before the reaction, and then we have the different reaction in this case of SiH3 to decompose forming hydrogen and SiH2. So there are different technologies, and in order to understand where reactions can happen on surface. So that's very, very important to understand, for instance, in interstellar conditions, how molecules can be formed at the surface of grains or ices at low temperatures. This is to illustrate this part of this chemistry. So, watching again the case of molecular hydrogen, there are more or less two mechanisms debated in the literature about how molecular hydrogen can be formed in the interstellar medium. That depends fundamentally on the kind of object that you are studying, for instance. If it is a dark cloud, or if it is the diffuse medium, or if it is a hot region, let's say. So the mechanism, the dominant mechanism, depends on the temperature conditions, the radiation flux, and the abundances, of course, of elements in interstellar media. So there are references exploring deeply how hydrogen molecular hydrogen can be formed, the time scale of the reaction, and how the molecule can go to the gas phase in order to put a huge density of this molecule in interstellar medium in general. So to summarize more or less, these mechanisms, the mechanisms to produce more molecular hydrogen. There are this work coming from Vakeland 2017, where there is a very, very interesting plot about which are the dominant mechanisms to produce, for instance, molecular hydrogen in the interstellar medium. So that depends on the densities of hydrogen, which are usually common of the order of 10 to 4 to 10 to 6 cubic centimeters. Then temperatures, we have more or less these values. In our case, we study core regions in general, regions with temperatures lower than 150 Kelvin, let's say, and the dust temperature, which is a very, very key parameter to understand the energy that can be taken from the grain, let's say, to produce molecular hydrogen and other molecules, for instance. So I recommend these references about to check more deeply this part about the astrochemical processes in the interstellar medium. Okay, let's move to this part of the presentation, observing molecules. I will speak about the role of radio astronomy in astrochemistry, which is quite relevant, and processes of molecular excitation, rotational infrared and submillimeter spectra, and something that is very, very important, which is about molecular abundances and how we represent or how we put the results in terms of relative abundances, which depends on the, for instance, and CO and H2 column densities, which are the most abundant molecules in the universe. So about the role of radio astronomy and astrochemistry. So radio astronomy is quite important because at these wavelengths, it is possible to check, to inspect, to observe the rotational transitions of molecules in the interstellar medium. This is quite important. This is at this window, this spectral window, we can see a molecular universe. It is also possible at infrared wavelengths, but at infrared wavelengths, you have fundamentally vibrations, but at radio wavelength, it is a kind of totally new universe in terms of excitation mechanisms, transitions, and it is possible to detect a lot of spectral lines coming from different molecules that at this moment all the community is trying to characterize in order to understand the molecular composition of the interstellar media. So in this plot, coming from McGuire 2018, it is a cumulative number of detection per facility and per year. So more or less all this history started at the 70s with the invention of radio observatories and with the detection of small molecules up to bigger molecules, as today, for instance, with the detection of benzonitril, let's say. So you can see that there is increasing across the years in numbers of new detection of molecules. And I put this image that I took by in 2018, I think so, I don't remember very well, at the Iran 30 meters telescope in Spain, because it is one of the of these facilities with a lot of discoveries of new detection of molecules of the interstellar medium, as you can see here, for instance, in this plot of the cumulative number of detections per facility and per year, right? So I was curious about some facts from one of the most requested facilities, like the ALMA interferometer, which is one of the most interesting instruments to do astrochemistry at this moment, which is the ALMA interferometer located at the Atacama Desert in Chile, which is an array of between, I don't remember the at this moment the exact number of antennas, but it is maybe between 50 and 60 antennas to do interferometry. And it is possible to map interstellar regions, to understand the morphology, the chemical composition, the molecular composition, temperatures, densities, and all this. So, for instance, the cycle 6, which was before the pandemic, more or less, there were this number of proposals, a lot of proposals in the ALMA Cycle 6. And one of the most important topics of one of the key topics, let's say, not one of the most important, but the key topics was, for instance, interstellar medium, star formation, and astrochemistry. But of course, there are other research fields which use astrochemistry to understand the morphology, chemical composition, and all this. So all this is related, interstellar medium, star formation, astrochemistry, and circumstances, at least in the experience that I have at this moment, right? So this is the role of radio astronomy in astrochemistry at this moment. I try to put this pie chart here, which corresponds to the cycle 6 of the ALMA at that moment. So these are the scientific keywords from the grade A and B projects at that cycle 6. So here you can see, for instance, astrochemistry, I put here in black color, which more or less 20 proposals in this degree classification, the grade A and the B. But there, as I told to you in the past slide, there are correlated topics to astrochemistry. For instance, I also work with low mass star formation, which use emission from molecular gas, high mass star formation, which also use information coming from the astrochemistry, outflow jets and feedback, and interstellar medium and molecular clouds in general. All these topics, sometimes it is very hard to separate which this is astrochemistry, this is another thing. So all they are related. So this is more or less the current role of radio astronomy in astrochemistry and vice versa. It's quite relevant for the area. Okay. So let's move to a basic general peek about molecular excitation. About molecular excitation of molecules. So it is needed to consider a classical model of how a molecule can rotate and with the quantum implication of this, of course. So this is the case of CO, for instance. CO after molecular hydrogen is the second most abundant molecule. And then we have this kind of model, right? With the equation of including the quantum numbers of and the inertial moment of a molecule like CO. But this is a very easy one. But in the interstellar medium, there are a lot of molecules with different structures, with different geometries, with different rotational modes. So it is quite complicated if you go to, for instance, let's say ammonia or methylacetylene, right? So those are the equations of the inertial moment of these molecules, linear rotors, symmetric rotors, spherical rotors. In this case, I put here just molecules that they are common, let's say, in the interstellar medium. OCS, HCN, HNC, ammonia, methylacetylene, methane, and phosphine, which was, I told about phosphine in the past seminar at Origins, because it was a great discovery in Venus. Today is debated, but detect something like phosphine is quite relevant in thinking in astrochemistry and astrobiology too. So yeah, so about the molecular excitation, more or less the energy involved in molecular transitions include electronic energy, vibrational and rotational one. And in this diagram, which is quite common, we can see, for instance, electronic transitions and the vibrational ones and the rotational ones, which are the weakest between all of them. They are very, very weak in terms of energy. So for this reason, we use these wavelengths to observe those molecules and also the environments where these transitions are stimulated is at very cold temperatures and at very, let's say, low densities. So this is more or less the kind of excitation processes in a molecule, electronic ones, vibrational ones, rotational ones. Okay, and this black body image of the of different processes at different wavelengths and frequencies, we are more or less at this region that I put in cyan color, the radio wavelength and submillimeter wavelength, whose temperatures are very low. If you pay attention on this, it's more or less at 10 Kelvin, 100 Kelvin, and at these temperatures, you can detect these rotational transitions, vibrational transitions of molecules. And also, it is quite important because they can survive in this kind environments. They are not destroyed by a strong radiation or thermal shock or violent processes. So it is quite important to study the composition of these regions at these very low temperatures. And these wavelengths are important to observe all these physics and chemistry of molecules in interstellar medium. And this is the classical equation about the radiative transfer, including Einstein coefficients. So we have, for instance, here the two levels, the lower and the upper one. So we have processes of emission, absorption, and all the equation about the population of states, where we have column densities, partition functions, and temperatures. And all this is speaking about a Boltzmann distribution if we consider and if we assume local thermodynamic equilibrium, which is a keyword in all these radiative transfers at these wavelengths. So one of the, if we consider local thermodynamic equilibrium, it is possible to use the populational diagram method, which is a method to estimate, for instance, excitation temperatures of molecules in these regions at low temperatures, and also the column density of the upper state of the excitation. Considering two, for instance, parameters like beam dilution effects, parameters like the solid angle of the antenna, and the solid angle, for instance, of the region that you are observing, the opacity of the region, if the emission is optically thin, is optically thick, you need to consider too the partition functions of the molecules at different temperatures, and also the energy of the upper state and the temperature in general. So I here put two images, one of them about H-C3N, a common molecule observed in the interstellar medium, temperatures, let's say low temperatures, 22 Kelvin in this case. And this is a kind of rotational diagram. The slope is associated with the temperature of the region. And in this case, about E methanol, with a higher temperature, for instance, 50 Kelvin temperature and a different density. So this kind of method is very common in order to estimate column densities, rotational temperatures, adopting local thermodynamic equilibrium. I here put an image about HNC and HNC containing the 13 carbon atom, and also HNC, but with 15 nitrogen. The reason of use this is because isotopologues, they are not very dense, so the emission can be considered as optically thin. So you can estimate what is, for instance, the temperature of the region coming from this low abundant species. So this is a kind of rotational diagram coming from three lines of this species with temperatures lower than 50 Kelvin. And how the emission looks, here I put the spectra in black color, in this case, is the real signal, and in red, the model using LTE conditions. Same thing here, but the model is in blue color. And you can see also that the abundance and the intensity of the lines is correlated with the abundance of the molecule. So we expect that this kind of molecule is more abundant than the second one, considering that 13 carbon is more abundant than 15 nitrogen. Okay, intensities when local thermodynamic equilibrium do not apply, right? So all in LTE is a very ideal world. It's wonderful, it's beautiful, it is easy to estimate temperatures, it's very nice, you don't have headache and all this. But sometimes the real life applies. So in some cases, you cannot apply LTE conditions because there are collisions stimulating excitation of molecules. So that's a different approach. But it is quite important to take into account this when LTE conditions do not apply. So collisional excitation and the excitation by electrons and protons, it is needed to be considered. Collisional ionization and three-barrier combinations, redistribution of angular momentum by collisions. All this is very, very complex, and this is a challenge in astrochemistry because you need to consider the density to see or to evaluate if LTE works or not. So in the case of non-LTE excitation molecules, when the gas is dense, for instance, this is the case of ambient gas like CO, CS, or ammonia, NH3. So this is a plot that I took from the book, Tools of Radio Astronomy. And then this is the correlation, the apparent correlation between a rotational temperature and the kinetic temperature of a molecule like ammonia. So if you are far from the LTE, you need to consider what is going on in terms of collisions with abundant molecules like molecular hydrogen or even helium or CO, for instance. So to understand or to apply these non-LTE methods, you can use, for instance, codes like RADx, which is based, let's say, on the large velocity gradient. It is necessary to consider statistical equilibrium calculations involving collisional and relative processes. Formalism is about the escape probability method, optical depth. Spectroscopy and collision level data are required. And these cases require calculations and in some cases, experiments. So this is the whole integration of astrochemistry, including observations, experiments, and theoretical approaches. So since there is not, an analytical solution to understand the conditions, temperatures, density, it is needed to include calculations using numerical methods. Monte Carlo is one of the most common to compute radiative transfer calculations. And one of the methods that we use between Monte Carlo is the Markov chain Monte Carlo at this moment, for instance. So coming from this Markov chain Monte Carlo, you can estimate kinetic temperatures, column densities, gas densities, and even spectral line parameters all together with a good machine, with a good cluster, you can have a calculation, let's say, in three hours, if all works well. I took this case of CN, because CN is possible to observe this radical at different wavelengths and sources. From the optics up to radio wavelengths. CN is an abundant radical in the tertiary medium. It is common to observe transitions at the GA zero level, G1 and J2, at different sources, not only different wavelengths, but different sources, including comets up to stargalactic sources, for instance. So CN is important because it is a chemical building block to produce more complex molecules. It is a thermonuclear diatomic species with a permanent electrical dipole. CN is correlated with the cosmic background radiation, let's say, with a temperature which is a little higher than 29 Kelvin, for instance. But there are some considerations that need to be analyzed, because CN suffers a lot of processes associated with collisions by electrons and radioactive processes and fluorescences light time that need to be considered of the radical for these implications of the cosmic background radiation. So in this case, I put two spectra of CN coming from the G331 source at the in the direction of the galactic center, more or less at 7 kiloparsec, the distance of 7 kiloparsec. And then we have here this spectra coming from the 2-1 transition and the 3-2-2 transition of CN. This is the emission as they look, coming from this couple of transition of CN at different frequencies and with a different spectroscopy. So this is a kind of emission of CN coming from submillimeter wavelengths. But the story at infrared wavelengths is a little different. For instance, here I show to you this image in absorption of CN towards Cygnus OB2. So this is a different example of how CN can be observed at different wavelengths and at different sources. Then, in the case of comets, CN is abundant in comets, and this is an image of CN at wavelengths in the visible and ultraviolet transitions in comets, right? This attracted my attention because this image was associated with the NASA Deep Impact mission, which was about the how to observe and to study the comet Tempel 1. This was in 2005. So here we have two kind of spectra after and before the collision of the comet in order to understand properties of this comet. So CN is very, very abundant and common in comets. Indeed, this is a bit of a funny story about the comets of the past century in 1910. So at the first decade of the past century, which was very common because, well, it was nice because it was a year of comets, the Halley Comet and other ones. So there was a kind of fear, not only about the eventual collision discussions of a comet, it will impact us, it will destroy the planet, and all these common fears in the human history, but also poisoning by a cyanogen, CN, was a public issue too. So not only this event of collision, but there was a knowledge about the possible chemical composition of the comet. So there was a kind of fear, not only by the eventual collision, but also by the poisoning by cyanogen, right? Okay, CN at different wavelengths, as I show in that in the past slide, CN as a cosmic thermometer is quite important because the spectral properties of CN are this one that you can estimate very, very, let's say, low temperatures, thanks to the transitions that CN can experiment in different wavelengths. So this is a kind of example, CN, that you can study at different wavelengths, this molecule, this radical, sorry. So, okay, About molecular abundances, let's speak a little about CO and molecular hydrogen. CO and molecular hydrogen, they are the most abundant molecules. So if we, this part of the abundances is quite important in order to compare the abundances of molecules between different sources, when this is possible, not always is possible. So you need, for instance, if you take methanol, how abundant is methanol? So you need to put this in a relative estimation with respect to hydrogen, which is the most abundant molecule. The problem is the hydrogen is not this visible at this wavelength. So you need to correlate this with another molecule, an observed one, like CO. So abundances is quite, I put here this image, for instance, to realize one affine is very concentrated if one of different one is diluted. So it is important to estimate molecular abundances relative, in this case, to hydrogen, molecular hydrogen. But it is not easy. It is quite complicated, and it is a matter of an open debate. Even here in this reference, I put here this, this title, the ratio of carbon monoxide to molecular hydrogen in interstellar dark clouds, because there is a way to correlate the abundance of hydrogen if you have observation of carbon monoxide. In the past decade, there was a panel indeed to discuss this matter, the CO and H2 abundance ratio. So this is quite important. This is almost the last step to show a result, to put all the detection of these molecules as a molecular abundance relative to hydrogen. In the case of elements, it is a little similar. They are put in relative to hydrogen, but the atom, not the molecules. And we have different references and different studies reporting cosmic abundances in the solar system. If we have, for instance, this table, putting the abundance of carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, and more elements in comparison between the solar system and Orion A. In the case of molecules, in order to estimate abundances, for instance, in the galaxy, in how molecules are distributed in galaxies or in regions, you take, for instance, abundant molecules, like in the case of formaldehyde, H2CO. So it is possible to estimate how abundant is a region in terms of how abundant is molecules like formaldehyde. And it is also useful because you can estimate easily isotopic ratios containing 13 carbon, 18 oxygen, 17 oxygen, for instance. In the case of molecules containing nitrogen, it is possible to use isotopologies from HCN and HNC, indeed. Oxygen, you can also use, for instance, formaldehyde or CO. In the case of molecules containing sulfur or silicon, it is very common and easy, let's say, to observe emission coming from SiO, CS, and SO2. So those are isotopic ratios coming from molecules detected from molecules like formaldehyde and molecules containing sulfur and silicon atoms at the galactic center at 4 kiloparsec in the local ISM, solar system, carbon stars, and at the nuclei of galaxies. Okay. There is something very interesting that attracted my attention from some approaches in order to understand this correlation between CO and H2, which is a very challenging one. Because there is a kind of van der Waal interaction between CO and H2 forming a complex. So there is a question. How CO and H2 are correlated? in terms of abundances, but it is possible to study too this kind of complex COH2 via van der Waals interactions. So this is an approach that researchers are doing at this moment in order to try to understand this correlation between these two abundant molecules. Here I put a table about, for instance, van der Waal coefficients of molecules detected in interstellar medium. We have CO, CO2, molecular hydrogen with a very low value, water, H2S, ammonia, SO2, in a bigger one, which is C6HC, but this is not observed in the, or at least I'm not sure, it is a cycle or a linear molecule, but with a very, very high value for a van der Waal coefficient. So this is coming from a result from Potapov 2016 about if it is possible to observe this kind of complex, van der Waal complex COH2. CO, for instance, come with parahydrogen, and in other cases with orthohydrogen, molecular hydrogen. And those are the frequencies at which we should look for this kind of complex. But it is not clear still if it is possible to observe this kind of complex between CO and molecular hydrogen. In the case of comets, relative abundances are reported in terms of the most abundant molecule, which is water. In the comets, which is a kind of a solid ball, let's say, a solid rock, let's say, full of water, solid water, it is an ice. So in the case of comets, abundances are not reported, of course, in terms of molecular hydrogen, but in terms of the most abundant molecule, which is water. So in this case, I put a result, for instance, of abundance of molecules in this study, coming from the Churyumov Gerasimenko comet, right? So these are the molecules observed in this comet reported in terms of the presence of water, relative to water, in the case of comets. Okay, let's move to this part of the presentation about methods and tools. And this is a very practical one. So to cite an example, I put here observations that we have carried out during the last five years, more or less, between 2015 and the last year, using the APEX telescope in order to study the molecular composition of hot molecular core sources. So, as I showed to you in the previous slides, this is an example of a collection of spectral data during these years, including more or less 50 hours of observations in these years using different instruments within the telescope. So it is easy to identify abundant species like CO, CS, HCN, OCS. In some cases, other molecules like H, C3N, but if you would like to go deeper and to understand which weak lines are, you need to study more spectroscopy and to have the catalogs and to reduce the data and all this. So this part of the presentation is about all this. This is more or less the sources that we are trying to study: protostellar objects, massive ones towards the galactic center, using catalogs coming, for instance, from Brofman 1995, using observations of CS based on the transition 2-1. So these are candidate sources of massive protostellar objects. When you observe these sources, there appears a lot of spectral lines associated to molecular processes. So it is very, very, it is like a astrochemical laboratory of formation of molecules in these regions. So this is how looks also this spectral surveys, but at the low regime, the low mass regime of star forming regions. The past one is massive protostellar objects. This is the case of low mass protostellar objects. But again, what you can observe at this wavelength is a lot of molecular transitions corresponding to very common molecules like CO, but also to complex organic molecules, prebiotic molecules too. So it is quite interesting to do this kind of exercise and characterization of these spectral lines and radiative processes. So the line analysis is composed by observations, data coming from experiments, data coming from calculations, and all this to try to do the characterization of the emission coming from these sources or the absorption. So this is the case. You need to use databases that put together all the spectral information, including sources, including the spectroscopy, including references, if that molecule was already detected in other astronomical environment. And I put here some examples, SPLATALOG, the JPL spectroscopy database, the COLON database, and the LOAS database. So you can check on these databases about all the spectroscopy at these frequencies. And to do identification, there are a couple, or there are some criteria for new detections. I summarize here one of them, putting here this example of the identification of CH3CCH in a hot molecular core, which is very easy because the spectral signature is quite easy to identify. So first of all, you need to think in contamination. You need to have rest frequencies, which is combined by laboratory work, a frequency agreement between the frequency at the lab and the frequency of the source. You need to consider beam dilution effects between the solid angle of the source and the solid angle of the your antenna, and the relative intensities, which are associated with the abundance and with the spectral properties of the molecule per se. So it is important to consider Einstein coefficient, the frequencies, the energy levels, and the rotational temperatures in general. So in the practice, to do all this, the data reduction can be done using software like the Gildas Class 90 package, where you can use the software to reduce the data and to analyze the data to do the identification. Combining, for instance, databases like the CDMS and the JPL spectroscopy databases. And information about the telescope and receiver parameters, you can also find in websites like this of the IRAN 50 meters telescope. So this information is available to introduce into the software in order to do the data reduction and the data analysis. So I put here a little example about how CLASS can use a different package like WITS, in which you can do the line analysis. You can compute or run LTE simulations using databases like the CDMS and the JPL database. This is how it looks, the CLASS extension of package, which is useful to do this kind of analysis. In the case of formamide, a molecule that we work a lot in the past in order to observe them, to observe it in various sources. So you can, I put here an example. You can in the software you can put, for instance, the interval of frequency, and you can invoke, let's say, the number of lines at this interval, and then you need to play with the spectroscopy. What is the frequency? What is the Einstein coefficient? What is the intensity of the line in order to do the identification? So after applying a lot of filters, you can say something like, oh, let's say this looks like this line is this transition at this frequency. So more or less, this is the way as the line identification can be done in this kind of software. Another one is CASIS, which is a more interactive one. You can use install this in Linux and Windows. And you can play with the software. You can put the lines, put your data, the frequencies, all the spectroscopy, in order to do the line identification, let's say, in a more friendly way with the user. So this is an example, as you can do, you can identify, for instance, a line of HC3N towards a protostellar shock. So this software is also use all the databases like the CDMS, GPL, NIST, Splatalog, and also you can construct your own database into the code, right? About some of the CASIS functionalities, using CASIS, you can, besides, apart from the line analysis identification, you can compute, you can do calculations about radiative transfer to estimate kinetic temperatures, extension temperatures, velocities, column density, and molecular hydrogen densities. This is an example of a rotational diagram coming from the molecule CS observed at different frequencies. Among other sources, more related with interferometry, with interferometry techniques, you can use, for instance, Gilda's, the package mapping of the Gilda software. You can run in your terminal in order to do the data reduction and analysis. Also CASA for ALMA, for instance, to do all the data treatment in reduction. And another one, but I'm not very familiarized with this, which is the APES, the Astronomical Image Processing System. All these two, as tools of data reduction and data treatment, but for interferometry, different from single dish observations. I would like to speak a little bit about the Large Latin American Millimeter Array project, which consists of a single dish, which is being constructed in Argentina. This is a collaboration between Brazil and Argentina to construct a telescope, an antenna, of 12 meters, and it will be located in the northern region of Argentina. And this is a project I was working the last year for this, and this will be a facility maybe for the next years, very useful to do astrochemistry in this part of the world. Okay, I will skip this slide, sorry, and just to talk about implications and challenges and some works that we made in the past, a search for cyanopolyanes in protostellar shock. In general, a molecule like HC3N is present everywhere in our galaxy, in external galaxies, in comets, in everywhere it's present HC3N. So it can be used to understand the physical conditions of the interstellar medium, the galactic or extragalactic one, for instance, and has a very interesting chemistry. Starting from the small molecules like C2H, radicals, HNC, CN, and C2H2. So it is a very friendly molecule to do maps and also spectral lines in different protostellar objects, massive or low mass protostellar objects. In the case of massive protostellar objects, using data from ALMA and APEX together, we made an investigation during these years to understand the physical conditions of a hot molecular core, which has temperatures higher than 100 Kelvin or lower than 100 Kelvin. That depends on the evolutionary stage of the source, if water was sublimated from the grains. So this kind of source is very interesting because it has molecular outflows, violence ones, has a hot core, has a cold core, in a very complex chemistry. So it was possible, for instance, to observe isocyanic acid, HNCO, which is correlated with formamide, at least in speaking about abundances in some chemical processes. Spectral lines, for instance, in these sources are very characteristic, and you can see a tail. This speaks about the activity of the outflow, for instance, coming from spectral tracers like HNCO. So in these sources, it was possible to run astrochemical simulations in order to understand how a molecule like HNCO is formed in these sewers at different times as a function of time for a molecular outflow, and considering different properties, temperatures, cosmic ray ionization rates, and so on. With respect to LTE and non-LTE, analysis, which is a very challenging thing to do, as I commented in the past slides, LTE is wonderful, non-LTE is wonderful, but it is difficult. You need to have collisional data in order to understand how collisions can excitate molecules. And one of the interesting words is about H3, and again, because it is possible to include collisional data in order to understand how the molecule is excited. Okay, something very interesting here is about ortho and para ratios in molecule and interstellar molecules. Molecules including hydrogen, molecular hydrogen, depending on the orientation of the nuclear spin. You can have molecules in an ortho state or in a para state. So it is debated that maybe in astrophysical environments, this property can be studied to understand how this conversion from ortho to para states occurs across time. So in some cases, you can observe with a high spectral resolution, the ortho forms from methanol, for instance, or the para form from methanol. So this kind of interconversion between spins, it is correlated, can be correlated with collisional processes and maybe with the time. So it is debated, it is discussed if we can use this property as a, for instance, astronomical clock to understand the evolution of protostellar objects. So in laboratory, there are researchers studying this kind of conversion of ortho to para forms in some molecules in the gas phase, also in the solid phase, this conversion induced by collisions with smaller molecules like molecular hydrogen. In the interstellar medium, there are some initiatives to measure the ratios ortho-para of some molecules correlated with the temperature of the source. In this case, this work from 1993 explored the ortho-para ratios of CH3CN in TNC1 in the Taurus molecular cloud. More recently, that occurred but with methanol in a ion stellar object. So this is the ratio between the ortho and para force as a function of the spin temperature. So it is discussed if, for instance, we can use that property as a clock to evaluate the evolution of a protostellar source. Okay, just to finish, I said to my colleagues from the experimental part that I would like to speak a little bit about chirality in the interstellar medium, which is about enantiomeric species. We know that nature use L amino acids and the sugars. That's very, very interesting and very curious why nature use that. So there are some experiments that show that this kind of chirality can be induced by motions or radiation or physical processes. So why in our genetic material we have L amino acids and D sugars? It is something tricky, something curious. So in the interstellar medium, there are some simulations, experimental ones, trying to understand how chirality can be induced in the interstellar medium. Why, for instance, there are L amino acids and D sugars and so on. So there are so experiments that condensate a sample of CO, CO2, water, ammonia, methanol, and then these ices are irradiated with polarized light, right? So depends on this polarization, you can have maybe L substances or D substances. So this is very curious in the context of, for instance, how the grains in the interstellar medium can be affected by polarized light coming from the stars and all this, and how this can induce this kind of enantiomeric axis in other molecules. In the MOX string case, after the evolution of our of us, which you we are using L amino acids and the sugar. So this is something that I said that I would like to comment just to finish the presentation. Another challenge is observation and prediction. How can we integrate, how we can integrate observations and simulations in order to predict astrophysical data, simulated astrophysical data, like in this case. This is not a real spectra, a real observation, but a simulated one. Using kinetics, using a network of reactions evaluated for a protostellar source, and then combining all this with the radiative transfers in order to know more or less what will be the intensity, the expected intensity of a molecule. Okay, that's it, and thank you very much.
Okay, Edgar, thank you very much. This was a very, very interesting topic. And I think I have tons of questions, but I will prefer the people to make the questions. So before to do that, I would like to ask you for one small thing. Can you tell us in 1 minute what is your actual research?
In 1 minute, my actual research is, yes. It's about observation of CH3-CCH. I'm working about that. 2 weeks ago, a master student that I had, we had an accepted publication, and it was about, yes. So we're very happy about that because it was about CH3CCH, a molecule that we observe in a hot molecular core. So more or less, this is the hot topic at this moment for me.
Yeah, it's very interesting. I have to add that this is one of the few topics in astrophysics where you can do lab research. Generally, you can either do computational simulations, you can do observations, but you cannot test, more or less. Yeah. What you do in the lab is amazing, is very, very interesting, and it's incredible that we have some area of astrophysics that allows you to touch in some way what we see in the universe. So I will bring the first question that is in the chat. In the meanwhile, we have the people in the room here at the university preparing themselves to make you personal questions. Well, no, sorry, no personal question. Questions in person, by the way. Sorry. I will transfer you the first question that is in the chat. It's from one of our students here at the university. It's Jerónimo Calderón. He's asking, what are the benefits provided by a single dish like JAMA for astrochemistry? I've always heard that it's better to have an array of smaller antennas doing interferometry than only one big dish.
Yeah, that's a very interesting question and an important one about this single dish and interferometric techniques. The benefit is huge. Because to do interferometry, you need more antennas, you need a bigger array, and the demand of time is higher. So normally you go to an interferometer having before a good idea from a single dish. So first of all, you need a single dish observation in order to have a good idea and a good project about why you would like to use an interferometer. So more or less, this is the way. So the benefit of a single dish like Yama will be the possibility to use a single dish to observe for first time a given phenomena, and then you study this, you characterize this, and then you go to an interferometer in order to have a better spatial resolution. So more or less, this is the benefit, but the benefit is huge because the competition is high. So you need to, as you have more facilities, it's better for this science in general.
Okay, thank you very much. So part of the things of having people online and people in present, well, here at the university, is that they can say hi somehow. So now what you see is Herman. Herman is at the classroom with the students, and they are all there hearing you, as you can see.
Oh, what a beautiful room.
It's a big room, and you're being broadcasted over there.
Hey, guys.
They're saying hi to you.
Very happy to see you. All wearing masks. That's correct.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, well, biosafety measures.
Wonderful, wonderful. I hope you like the presentation, and sorry if I bore you.
No. It was very, very interesting. So we have another question here in the chat. It's from one of our students here as well. What is exactly the problem with H2 being formed without the help of a surface?
Yes, the problem is that the time scale for a collision is huge. So in the gas phase, to collide two atoms of hydrogen is like a nightmare. That never will happen, let's say. But if you put all this on a surface, it's easier because atoms can migrate and then react. But in the gas phase, the events, the number of events is lower in comparison with the number of events in a surface. So that's the difficult. And this is the first one, the number of collisions that you can have in the gas phase. Then the energy of it is another problem, because you need that these atoms collide with enough energy to react. So that's very difficult. So we have a problem of kinetics, we have a problem of thermodynamics. And the grain solved this. The calculations show that.
Very interesting. So I'm asking Herman if you have any questions over there.
I'm wondering if you can suggest databases for astrochemical reactions.
Oh yeah, sure, absolutely. There are two of them. The KIDA database, KIDA. And the UMIS database. So these databases collect thousands of chemical reactions in the interstellar medium, the KIDA and the UMIS database. In the case of KIDA, KIDA has 7,500 reactions, a lot of reactions. And UMIS, It is lower. It is like 7,000, something like. But they are very useful for astrochemistry.
Okay.
What could we do with those?
Oh, that's a hard question, because that put me in problems.
Problems in which sense?
Problems in collaborations and all this.
Oh, okay, so we can skip the answer.
No. But I can say I use a lot KIDA database. The KIDA database, they are close colleagues. But UMIS is very, very interesting too. So, yes.
We have another question here in the chat. It's from Daniel Nino. He's asking you, are there any expectations in astrochemistry with the James Webb Space Telescope?
My dear friend, that's a very, very difficult question. I confess, I think about 3 weeks ago about that. How can we use the James Webb Space Telescope to do astrochemistry? I look for information at the website, but it is not clear what should be the impact of or at least I don't know, of the telescope in astrochemistry. So I'm not sure if astrochemistry is a priority for that mission. Not sure. I think about, but I'm not sure about.
Okay. So if you have to give an advice to all the students and the people that is seeing you right now, what will be that advice?
The advice would be be curious. Curiosity is all in this business. I don't know. I think that the world is changing by the pandemic and not necessarily in a good way. I am optimistic, but the things are weird right now, I think, in everything. But I think that curiosity is the essence of this. Curiosity and tenacity to go ahead in your projects and all this, and maybe don't have a lot of expectation because this is science and everything can go wrong. So okay. Curiosity and tenacity. Be curious is like my formula.
Thank you. Edgar, where are you right now?
I am in Colombia. I am in Bogota.
But you're planning to move these days, right?
Yes. I'm planning that.
Where are you going?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure because I am applying for different positions. So I am waiting. I think that I need to, I mean, here in Colombia, I will be up to the end of the year.
Yes.
But I am spending time with my family, with some friends, and all this. But about, so the I will move, but here in the country, but about the next step in science, I need to speak at least to the next year. So I would be happy to visit you, maybe.
Hope so.
That would be great. But yes, that's it.
Okay, so Edgar, thank you very much. I think that if any person is interested in contact you, I will just receive emails and I will just forward to you with many questions that they could have and they can be sent it to you directly. Thank you very much. And to all of you, I hope to see you tomorrow for our next talk. And thank you very much for the participation today. Have a good day.
Thank you. Bye, guys. Take care.